What a wonderful occasion this has been. I mean, we'd have to replay the whole thing to do it full justice. But unfortunately, it hasn't given me much time to talk. So I've got a way of doing that now that I hadn't planned on. So I'm going to be talking about conditional probability. It may take a little time for people to get it. But what I'm going to ask is, for the people who understand it already, and we know that's all the students who took the class and talked and they're making all kinds of money doing this in the world, but there are other people who don't get it, right? So I want a commitment from those of you who understand what this means to teach it as soon as you get home to the people who didn't get it. And why do I want to do this? Because I want to take the time to learn something in the spirit of the Decision Education Foundation that everybody should know and virtually nobody does. This all came about because one day in class, it must have been well over 20 years ago, there was an article in the newspaper that said a judge in Florida, judging drug cases, you know, marijuana, heroin, all that kind of stuff. And why this made the newspaper out here in Palo Alto was that he had decided, he said, you know, what I found is that while I get marijuana distributors and heroin distributors and all that kind of thing, what I find is the people who have a problem with heroin started on marijuana. So, and that's the majority of them, he said. Normally, you know, you get a lower sentence for dealing marijuana than you would for heroin, but I'm going to sentence you people who are marijuana dealers as if you were heroin dealers, because that's, you know, the thing that led into the heroin. We decided to let the class work on this problem of the marijuana and the heroin. So on the left, the class, we divided M as being a heavy marijuana user, H a heavy heroin user, a little more detailed than that, but that's the idea. And so these were adults in America, and we said, okay, what's the chance at that time? This is, you know, many years ago now, before it was legal. They said, well, the chance of being a heavy marijuana user was about 1 in 10, and 9 in 10 of not being one. Okay? It's not just somebody who's tried it once or something like that. And then they said, okay, well, the chance, if you were a heavy marijuana user, what's the chance you'd become a heavy heroin user? And they said, well, about 1 chance in 100 that you, if you were a marijuana user, you'd become a heavy heroin user at that time. And if you were not, M with a prime on it, if you were not a marijuana user, the chance of being a heavy heroin user would be 0.001, 1 chance in 1,000. Okay? And that was pretty much, no one argued with those numbers. But then we said, okay, we're going to use that and figure out what would be the probabilities to these same distinctions in the other order. And we do this a lot. We switch the order. We say, first let's think about heroin, and then let's think about marijuana. What we did was say, okay, think of this like water flowing through a pipe. And so, at the beginning, we say, okay, 10% of the water flows up to the marijuana and 90% down to the not marijuana smoker. And then of that water, 1% goes up to being a heroin user and 99% down to not. Whereas on the bottom, if they were not heavy marijuana users, only 1.01 fraction of the water would be heroin users, and 1 minus that, or 0.999, would not be. So notice the only thing we're doing here of a mathematical nature is arithmetic. It's just, you can do the arithmetic required for this on your cell phone, okay? But now let's say, suppose we had thought about these different events in the other order. We wanted to say, okay, well, what's the chance that a person will be a heavy heroin user, and then the chance they'll be a heavy marijuana user given they're a heroin user? In other words, you're going to put the order just different, and now we're going to flow the water through over there. Well, the neat thing about this is once you know where the water ended up on over here, you just copy it to the corresponding place over on this side. So just going down the 0.001, 0.099, 0.0009, and 0.8991, they just get copied over here to these four points with the middle two switched in order, just because of the way the graphic is drawn. Okay? And now once we know that what water ended up at the end, we know how much must have gotten here. That's the sum of these two. And what about here? It's the sum of those two. And then what about the split? How much went up and how much went down? Well, that's the ratio of 0.01 to 0.009, or 0.526 to 0.5474. Okay, so what have we learned here? Well, the class said on the left here, their knowledge about the relationship between being a heavy marijuana user and being a heavy heroin user. Using that very same knowledge, they just said, well, suppose we look at it in the other order. Now what have we got? Well, now look at this number here. That's the amazing one. This says the chance of having been a marijuana user, serious one, if you were a heroin user, is 0.526. And that's exactly what the judge was noticing in his courtroom. Okay? He was saying, gee, you know, a lot of these people who are heroin users started on marijuana, okay? And so he threw this guy in jail. However, we see that the mistake that he made was confusing the probability of H given M, which is 0.01, for the probability of M given H, which is 0.526. So because he didn't understand probability, he put the guy in jail for the wrong reason. Now this is a very common example, and all it takes is arithmetic. This is not studying calculus or anything like that. It's just arithmetic, and yet most people can't think this way, and it has very serious effects. This was interesting and showed the problem you get into when you don't understand conditional probabilities. It would be bad enough if that's where it ended, but what happened next was that I had a bunch of medical doctors who came back to Stanford for a special deal, like some kind of fellowship program, and they were taking decision analysis. And at this point, when they went through the first example, the one that we've just discussed, said, oh, well, you know, we can understand why lay people might make this mistake, but we're trained doctors, right? So we decided to go a little bit further, okay? And we said, okay, let S be being these are all adults now, being a heavy smoker in the United States, and L get lung cancer. So the group said, this group of doctors said, about one chance in four of being a heavy smoker in the US, and that was true at the time, statistically. And then if you're a heavy smoker, there was a 1/10 chance of getting lung cancer, and if you weren't a heavy smoker, there was a 1% chance of getting lung cancer. Okay? Now, that 10% chance of getting lung cancer is nothing to sneeze at, because after all, Russian roulette would be one chance in six, and that's not a great idea with a revolver. So one chance in 10 of getting lung cancer is pretty serious. But the point is, it's a 1/10 as large as that, 0.01, if you're not a heavy smoker. Now, I had a guy who graduated with me from high school, went to MIT, graduated. I saw him throughout his whole life. And at the end of his life, he got lung cancer, never smoked a day in his life, nor associated with any smoker. So that 0.01 is for real. Okay. But what was interesting is here's the group assessment, and all of a sudden, this guy jumps and says, this can't be right. Why not? He said, well, you know, I'm a I'm an oncologist. I deal with lung cancer, and my lung cancer ward is full of heavy smokers. Okay, flow the water, and there you got it. The chance of if you get lung cancer, the chance that you were a heavy smoker is about 0.77. Of course this guy's lung cancer ward was full of heavy smokers, but had no connection to the one chance in 10 of getting lung cancer if you're a heavy smoker. Now notice this is when they would talk about, you know, your frying lungs and all this on TV, like if you're a heavy smoker, you're sure to get lung cancer. No, it's bad enough that it's one chance in 10 that you don't have to pretend that it's even bigger than that. So this is kind of scary, and this is about conditional probability, and people, all it takes is arithmetic, and yet most people can't think this one through. Now, this is the kind of stuff I want kids to understand. If you can't think this through, you're in trouble in your life, and it's as simple as arithmetic. If it's not clear enough on the time we've had here, I suggest you get your DA qualified associate to spell this out for you and make sure you get 100% on this assignment. And so much for decision education for the children and for all of us. Done.